is wunderbar. We're all living in America. 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 We're all living in America. America is wunderbar.
Is Tuesday, January 11, 2011. I'm at the home of Mr. Curtis. He is a person. Hey, you there? Okay. Yeah, this is the whistleblower, the federal whistleblower. Okay. At the New York skyline. Go ahead. Bang! That's what I'm talking about. Woo! Whoa, whoa, whoa. We getting deep here. What's this?
Part of history.
You go ahead, brother.
Sad, but it's part of history.
Part of history. So this is the big Watusi man, Dingo Mix Superfield Negro.
Yes.
All right. Well, you know, I put that whole skit together, and I finally see what it's supposed. That's what I'm talking about.
One of your veterans drew that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
One brother from Haiti did this.
Yes.
Outstanding. Nice place. Well. We can see you're not one of the impoverished, downtrodden, who's like one of these guys right here.
Oh, no.
See?
No.
That's Martin Luther King. That's Malcolm X, Elijah Muhammad, Frederick Douglass, all right here. And then this brother right here is what? Bang! Got the chains on his brain when these guys do not. Those guys are out there, and this guy is not. And that slave castle's door is busted and the key's right there. And he still ain't walking away from that.
Scared to leave.
Damn! Scared to leave. And that's my guy right here. That's my guy right here, Malcolm X. That's him right here. Well, let me see what else we got here. But, oh my. This is the one!
Yeah. Yeah, that's the one you were asking about, if that story was true about it. Yes, that's it.
That's what you had given me a copy of this, and I took it to the congressman's office.
Yes.
And you met with Ida Smith. I was there. I was an eyewitness. Bang, we're going to have to send this to Mr. Juan Cuba at the White House.
Sure.
Okay, and I've got a letter from the Justice Department, and I've been trying to show people, you know, what exactly, and people of authority. Because the newspapers have been, they don't want to print my story no more about the redlining scheme that I took to the congressman's office. And they did all kinds of things, calling me crazy, defamed me. The VA gave me a whole bunch of medication, which in fact I didn't need as a chemical restraint. So I got to do what I got to do. But I did speak to Mr. Juan Cuba. And it's time for me to now. And the last time I spoke to him was about getting those books to him.
Okay.
And now those books have disappeared at the congressman's office.
Wow.
So we can actually send him this. But what I wanted to do right now was if you could please take me back. Take me back to what happened, for you have taken these pictures. Hold this for me. Of this hangman's noose. That was when. This wasn't a...
This was found, it was in the locker room at the VA.
The Veterans Administration what?
St. Albans, New York.
St. Albans, New York, Veterans Administration, motor pool locker room?
Yes, correct.
Okay, and how long was this hanging there?
I don't know, I walked in January 25th, 2008, and I saw it.
Now, January 25th, 2008, and that's when you first saw that.
Correct.
And it lasted, and stayed there for how long?
No, they took it down immediately after that, after the police were notified.
Oh, so you called the police after that. There was a police report.
Yes, correct.
The police never called the press on this.
No.
When you took it to the congressman's office, did they call the press? What happened when you went to Ida M. Smith after I turned you over to her?
She spoke to me a few times about it, but nothing amounted out of it. I didn't get any feedback. I didn't get any change. And they told me that the federal government says it's legal to hang them. They said it's not.
Ida Smith told you said that the federal government said it's legal to put a hangman's noose.
They said that they're not illegal, but a noose is not against the law by the federal government. But a swastika is considered a felony hate crime, where a noose is not considered a hate crime.
And Ida M. Smith told you this?
Yeah. In the discussion, she was like, there's nothing she could do about it.
Okay. And are you aware that she ever contacted anybody at the Veterans Administration?
I believe she spoke to the union. Outside of that, I don't think it went much.
And then what happened to you?
Nothing. They offered to transfer me to Brooklyn, Manhattan, or Staten Island.
In other words, get you out of the St. Albans VA.
Yes.
Did they talk to you about who put that there? Did anybody ever ask you who put that hangman's noose in the locker room at the Brooklyn VA? I mean at the St. Albans VA on January 25th, 2008.
No. No.
Do you know who did it?
I don't know who did it, but I know whose coat rack it was hung on. I found it. It was hanging on one of my coworkers.
What was the name of the person's coat
rack it was hanging on?
Yes.
Frank Castellano.
Frank Castellano.
Correct.
What happened to Mr. Frank Castellano after you reported this?
Actually, he got a promotion from work leader to supervisor, and he wanted me to work under him after that. And when I told them that they were adding insult to injury, they told me when I told them I didn't want to work under his supervision after the incident,
yes,
they told me that they can transfer me to Brooklyn, Staten Island, or Manhattan, which I refused to go because I like St. Louis. I've been there 20 years, and I feel that I should not be transferred.
Now, were there other instances with Mr. Castellano or other Caucasian gentlemen at the Brooklyn VA Hospital Motor Pool that would lead you to think that there is an embedded racist environment in that motor pool?
Yes, I would think so.
Elaborate, yeah, please.
Well, a brief incident to me happened about 15 years ago. I came in there as a motor vehicle operator, and shortly after that, two Caucasians came in there, and they were made grade 8s, and I was a grade 7. And when I brought it to their attention saying, how come I'm a 7 and they're 8? They told me when I get an ACDL license, they'll make me a grade 8. Immediately, within 2 to 3 seconds, I reached in my pocket, handed them a class ACDL license, and they kept promising me to give me the grade, and they never did. So at the time, there were 3 tractor operators, which me being one, the first one,
mm-hmm,
and then the 2 Caucasians that came after me. So it was,
you had more time in grade, more time in service than they did.
Yes, and they were made 8s when they walked in the door.
Okay.
And I was never. Here it is 17 years later, and I'm still a 7.
So it looked like you sound like somebody, or federal government owe you some money.
Yeah, with some interest.
With some interest in back pay.
Yeah, 17 years.
Pay a little pain and suffering, a little humiliation and degradation.
And then this is what I'm rewarded with.
And bang! That's what you know Frank Castellano did it, don't you?
I would surmise that it does belong to him.
You suspect him?
Yes.
Now, tell me about the other guy who put a little hangman's noose in the hands of that female 6 months ago at the Brooklyn VA. You can tell it. You're a federal whistleblower. You should be protected. And we're sending this to the White House.
Well, another coworker of mine, I heard they had an incident too where somebody personally handed them a noose.
So a white guy handed a black woman
a
hangman's noose.
Yes.
And he ended up getting fired.
Yes.
She's on leave with mental distress. Well, what happened to you? How come you ain't all shell-shocked?
I am shell-shocked. It's a challenge each and every day to go to work. Matter of fact, it's hard talking about it, even like right now. I want to stop talking about it right now.
Did you go see some people, man? But I can't get into your medical records, man. I'm not going to get into that with you. Now, why don't you tell me your name? Tell me your name, and give me the name. I got to have a name.
Curtis Bench.
Curtis?
Bench.
You work at the Brooklyn VA?
St.
Albans VA?
Correct.
And you've been there 20 years?
22 years in April.
22 years in April?
Yes.
And you're a whistleblower?
Correct.
Are you afraid something's going to happen to you?
Yeah, I am. On a day-to-day basis, just going to work with the atmosphere and just all of the stuff that goes on and transpires. Oh, don't talk to him. He's a troublemaker. And
so they've been slandering your name?
Correct.
You've been profiled?
Correct. As a troublemaker. For standing up for my rights of not wanting to see a noose in a federal facility.
And you went to your congressman's office and they blew what? This is Mr. Jean-Claude Lafayette. This guy works for the court as an official translator. And this is the guy that's going to tell me exactly what I got in these papers here, which is lineage documents of birth certificates and deeds to properties. What you were going to tell me, go ahead and tell it to me, Jean-Claude.
Okay, you are entitled to the property since they belong to your mother.
And I also have a power of attorney from my brother, because it's not just me. It's me and my brother, and my brother's an older brother, and according to Haitian law, I believe that would make him the guy that would normally inherit, but he gave you the power of attorney, and that's what, and the guy that witnessed it is Jean Quebourg, the nephew of President Antonio Quebourg. That's my cousin.
Okay, here's what happened.
Okay.
Here's what happened. For your brother, for your mother, whatever he give you.
I'm going to bring you the power of attorney, too.
The power of the form, we have to go to the consulate.
I met with Felix Augustin already, and I met with him with a guy called Joao Bunio, who's the head of Homeland Safety.
It's in French?
Yes, everything's in French.
In French.
Right. And we'll get an official translation from the consulate.
The consulate, okay.
Right. I know, Jean-Claude. It'd be Madame Antoine.
Do you have the consulate stamp on it?
No, we can go get that. I know him personally.
It's not a question now. We're talking legally. You need to have the consulate.
That's right. We need to go do that. I need to go do that.
Consulate stamp, yeah.
I don't want for a come on here. It's another Haitian brother.
Consulate stamp, okay?
Okay.
And then it's very delicate in Haiti.
Yes, sir. Tell it to me. Go ahead.
Very delicate, my man. It's like when you have a heritage in Haiti, you need to have, in order to start, you need to have your mother, power of attorney.
I have it. I can bring it tomorrow. It's just,
okay.
I have it.
There's nothing that I can say right now without saying
the power of attorney from my older brother.
From your older brother.
But so that means when these Americans, when they told me that I was crazy and suffering from delusions of grandeur, and then called the Veterans Administration, had me medicated because I was supposed to be some African-American mudblood, some country Negro from down south who was stupid because I told them I was related to three presidents of my country. And Ambassador Jean-Marie de Latour is my first cousin.
But you have to understand, what you have to understand now, you are in the legal field. What's called is document.
And you know me.
Yeah. As soon you can get me.
With my brother signed.
That's it.
I can bring it back. I can bring it next week.
Okay, just bring it over and then we start.
And then
there.
We start going from
we,
there.
We're going from there. But at this moment there's nothing that we can do.
Okay,
we
now.
No
problem. So in other words,
you are only two brothers.
Yes, we are the only two brothers.
Okay.
So Jean-Claude, ça, ça veut dire là. Si qu'on y est, moi, quand même, et un congressman, deux sénateurs, tout, if I can bring all these, I got enough to bring all the black elected officials in this area, which I took all of the evidence to. And they tried to make me out to be crazy, man. Told me I mean, they acted like I was some kind of mudblood.
Did they take you to a mental institution?
Say what?
No, they did an Article 81 Enterprise Attended hearing. Human Resources did with New York City, with the city. Even Mayor Bloomberg sent me his regards when they came to evict me. No, they didn't win.
Did they got the record?
Yeah, I got the record. I got the index number, everything. That's why I'm suing everybody.
You're suing left and right, then?
How long you don't know me? Do I take stuff? You know I'm a little demon.
Okay, anyway, this is now it's an American business. You're suing left, right.
I have to. They disrespected.
I'm not on the title to it. I don't need to know much about it. The thing is, what's concerned me is to get your...
Left and get my money.
Yeah, that's it. In 80.
That's it.
Right?
Thank you.
Right.
This is Dr. Dreis. How you doing? 21 more days for my 55th birthday, and guess what I'm going to give you guys for Christmas? I'm going to give you the behind of every elected official in town, including the mayor and his agencies. Hey, L'Union fait la force. Bye-bye. This is a supplemental log for Friday, March 25th, 2011. This is the continuing saga of all of the plotters against me that helped destroy my life. This segment is exclusively for Judge Maria Ressos and the two other judges prior to her that I have known, just like I knew three chairmen of housing. I have known three chairmen of housing. And everybody would like to give a shout out to Miss Daniela. I think her YouTube name is Foxfly. She made a lot of wonderful suggestions. And I don't have to be such a wretched, wretched, melodramatic, think I'm an actor guy, other than just present the facts and the evidence as they are. I'm angry, I'm all of that, but that's for another time, another situation. This is about presenting the facts, recording it, in case something happens to me. This is the judgment in order of Judge Maria Ressos. Okay? And respondents ordered to show cause to restore this proceeding to the calendar, and the motion by Stephen S. Weintraub to be removed as guardian ad litem are consolidated for determination. In rendering this decision, the court considers the respondents' order to show cause, petitioner's affirmation in opposition, respondents' reply affirmation, and petitioner's surreply only. The court acknowledges receipt and did read respondent Philip Dreis's ex parte submissions. However, as they were ex parte, they cannot be considered by the court as it reaches its decision. That's what the problem is, because my guardian ad litem, Mr. Stephen Weintraub's hands were tied. This is a gentleman where I absolutely abused him, humiliated him, degraded him, blasted, crapped all over him, all over the internet, in front of everybody, all the way to the White House. He filed papers against the court, to the court against me. Judge Maria Ressos brought a big cop in there. I'm not violent. I don't need to do anything like that. I'm a pretty educated guy. I know what to do and what my limits are. But that shenanigan, that show, that performance that was calculated and performed did accomplish my goal. I finally got him to work for me instead of working for human resources to put me out, as you've seen in the last segment. And that's how it works. You've got, this is a war of the intellectuals against poor people who don't have an education. And it can be traced to a race-based situation because the people they're dealing with are the disenfranchised that have been apartheid on a federal reservation, which is the largest Indian reservation, the most populated Indian reservation in the United States of America, which is New York City Housing Authority, with approximately 800,000 tenants. But only 500 of them are registered, and those 300 are supposed to be in line to inherit that apartment, and it's the elimination of the administrative process that leads to the federal violations of diverting funds and Title VI violations, okay, under the Civil Rights Act of 1967, which is you're doing it to black people, you're doing it to Puerto Ricans, you're doing it to the disenfranchised, you're doing it to poor people that the federal government through Congress said that they take care of. But it was through the Clinton administration, it is alleged, that it was through the Clinton administration's desire to eliminate welfare that your governor was probably the premier architect who unleashed NYCHA, who dissolved any competent oversight, just like the regulators of the banks. It's been shown that the Democratic Party or the Democrats did orchestrate this big thing about this housing bubble. Okay? And they forced banks to make loans that they knew were going to fail. And then they want to blame somebody else for those bank failures and that all of that money that went down the tube. But it was designed to keep them in power. And when you're in power, you can keep cover things up. Okay? So this is what's happening, people. And in the surreply, let me show you here, where this guy says it's his, I'll read it, you know, you'll get it in the book and online, okay? You've got a NYCHA committing perjury in this document right here. This is the surreply. NYCHA commits perjury. Let me show you where. First of all, they said you got to be over 62 years old to be living there. And that I was the only one that was living in that apartment that that was in that development. Now we find out that's not true. And when we find out that's not true, the judge want to give them exemptions. You can't go back. Okay? Here we go right here. Which is Carol Brookins. Carol Brookins was living there before she turned 62. Okay? They didn't want to count that one. Let me give you another one. We're going to get Barbara. Barbara Davidson. Barbara Davidson is the sister of Margaret, who works for Councilman Comrie. And when it got this bad, Barbara Davidson right here, when it got this bad, they got her to move out of Shelton House. That's how big it is. Barbara Davidson had Davidson's been living there for 30 years. She didn't take the buyout, just like my aunt didn't take the buyout. That's why we were still in that apartment. They want to make it senior development, but they were supposed to give you $15,000. Okay? Now, this is the big deal right here. This is Mr. James Edwards in apartment 6N. He's got a Michelle Guy who lives there. She was born in 1976. What is she doing living there? He was born in 1947. Now, you see, he's got a son, and a daughter. A son and a daughter right there. Now, that's where the fraud comes in. Because in the paper, NYCHA reclassified him as a grandson, not a son. And the judge copied the exact same stuff,
That's what I'm going to hit her with, along with the trial transcript of where NYCHA said nobody under 62 lives there. Now, here is the beauty. This is Cynthia Hill, okay, with her husband, Babako, okay? She was born in 55, he was born in 66. But you got to understand, the lease, I've got it on video, that she said that they put him on the lease 3 years ago. That's another point of perjury for NYCHA in the settlement of the minutes or the transcript. Okay? That's how they're all busted. Just presenting the facts. Just presenting the facts. Thank you, Daniela. Thank you. Yeah. Supplemental log, November 29, 2010. This is Miss Cynthia Hill, the last real tenant association president that there was. They fixed the vote. Khadijah Wilson fixed the vote to put Neva Harper in there. And guess what, ladies and gentlemen? This is the evidence that right now we've got everybody committing perjury in court because you're not a senior citizen. You live there. And your husband's name was added on to the lease, what, 2 years ago?
2 years ago.
So now, when they put me out, weren't they doing a whole lot of wrong?
Yeah.
And Neva Harper, they propped her up as tenant association president so she can help eliminate people out of that building as a form of redlining.
Yes. She has a handicap apartment. She's not handicapped.
And so does Ozia Mitchell, who was also the last tenant association president that they put there to help.
Also marked a green of $20,000.
Oh, Cynthia Hill, former tenant association president, November 29, 2010, telling it like it is.
Thank you.